At the beginning of Pokemon Sword and Shield's VGC circuit, a lot of Generation 8 Pokemon caught the attention of players looking to find the next big thing. A new archetype built around one of the many brand new Pokemon and abilities introduced in the newest games was something that everybody wanted to take a crack at since the meta was still developing. Among these contenders in the early meta were Pokemon like Dragapult, Grimmsnarl, Toxtricity, and many others. But arguably the most hyped up of these new Pokemon was a slow rock type with a 4x weakness to ground and water moves and low offensive stats. But if this Pokemon got going, its opponent would have a rough time stopping its rampage in the field. This Pokemon is colossal. Its high-risk, high-reward playstyle and ability to go from one of the slowest Pokemon in the game to the fastest and strongest in the early meta made it one of the most successful and iconic Pokemon in Sword and Shield VGC. Let's talk about Colossal. Before we begin, I want to make a huge announcement. In the past, I made many of these long-form Pokemon video analysis essays, but I haven't been able to in a long time due to the time-consuming nature of their production. It's much more viable for a full-time student like myself to stick to creating daily battle videos to keep audience retention up, rather than take weeks to write and produce videos like the one you're watching. But I still love putting these types of videos out, so to remedy this, I've hired an editor. Obviously, editors need payment, and I'd still like to turn a profit off my ad revenue, so if you'd like to help fund these videos in exchange for early access to them, please check out my Patreon page. I'm hoping to have enough donations to be able to pay Jeremy here to make a video every week, so every dollar helps. To help in another way, be sure to leave a like and share this video with your friends to help the channel grow. But enough production talk, let's get into the video. Colossal has to be one of my favorite design Pokemon in the entire series, and I don't mean visually. It looks cool and all, but what I want to talk about are its stats, moveset, and abilities. In that sense, I think what Game Freak did with Colossal is nothing less than a work of art. Looking at its stats, we can see that Colossal is a rock and fire type Pokemon with an emphasis on being able to take hits. Its stats spread of 80 HP, 80 attack, 120 defense, 80 special attack, 90 special defense, and 30 speed would, at face value, make most players opt for a bulky EV spread, more focused on being able to sponge hits and possibly spread burns while chipping away at the opposing Pokemon's health over time. However, its typing is a detriment to using it as a defensive Pokemon, as you'd have a difficult time finding a team that doesn't have either a ground or water type, which are capable of making short work of even the bulkiest of Colossals. Its typing is more suited to utilizing its fire and rock stab moves for hitting the majority of Pokemon for either neutral or super effective damage, as these two types have excellent coverage together. Plugging rock and fire into the coverage calculator will show that a grand total of 35 Pokemon can switch in on Colossal's stab moves and resist them, with 571 being hit neutrally and 439 having to take a super effective hit. However, having 80 attack and special attack makes it a pretty mediocre offensive Pokemon. So in most cases, players would likely opt out in favor of an alternative rock or fire type. On top of that, its low speed makes it susceptible of being KO'd before it can even get a chance to use a move. So that begs the question, why do people use Colossal? Sword and Shield implemented a ton of new abilities that make their respective Pokemon more viable, but no Pokemon is as reliant on its ability as Colossal is. It currently is the only Pokemon with access to the ability Steam Engine. This ability causes Colossal to gain plus 6 stages of speed if it ever gets hit by a fire, or more importantly, water type move. Before Generation 8 of VGC, there had already existed an item in the game called the Weakness Policy, which would grant plus 2 attack and plus 2 special attack to the holder of the item if they were struck by a super effective move. Comboing Colossal's weakness to water with a Weakness Policy and Steam Engine will cause a modest Colossal EV'd with 252 special attack and 252 speed to go from the actual stats of a 145 special attack and 82 speed all the way to 290 special attack and an incredible 328 speed. This is faster than the following Pokemon: Chlorophyll boosted Venusaur, Swift Swim boosted Kingdra, and even the fastest Pokemon in the game, Regieleki, a Pokemon with a base speed stat of 200. So essentially, Big Rock goes Zoom. With this context added to Colossal's design, we have a whole new outlook on its stats. Those high defenses aren't there to allow Colossal to wall out and slowly beat a Pokemon, they're there to allow Colossal to tank a devastatingly strong water type move with just a little bit of health left, and then become the menace of a Pokemon it is at plus 6 speed and plus 2 special attack. Those low offenses and low speed aren't there because the developer doesn't want you to use it offensively, but to limit its offensive potential, as making it any stronger or faster would completely break the game's balance. While this strategy was originally seen as mostly a gimmick, its optimization over time and consistent results caused players to change their outlook on it and seek to push it to its limits. But the speed boost is only half the story when it comes to Colossal. In Generation 8, the Dynamax mechanic was added, which doubles the user's HP and grants it access to powerful versions of its base moveset for 3 turns. Colossal really relies on this mechanic to be viable, as its bulk can only comfortably tank water hits if it's Dynamaxed. Players are unsure of how well Colossal will perform in a non-Dynamax format, which is coming up soon, but many players are already saying it will drop drastically in usage. Not only because it won't be able to tank hits as well, but because it would lose access to a very important tool that only it has at the moment. A few select Pokemon were granted alternate forms called Gigantamax forms, which would alter their design slightly when they Dynamax and grant them access to a signature max move, with Colossal arguably having the best of them all. Colossal's signature max move is Max Volcolith, a powerful rock-type move that sets burning coals in the opponent's side of the field for 4 turns. At the end of each turn these rocks are active, any non-rock-type Pokemon will receive damage equal to 1/6 of their max health. That means that if a Pokemon is just sitting there vibing out in the field not being hit by anything, and it just so happens to not be rock-type, by the time the Volcolith has ended, it will have lost 2/3 of its health. The only other Pokemon in the game with access to similar moves are the Kanto starters, which have all seen very high usage in 2020 and 2021, so to put Colossal on the same level of Gen 1 fanservice is really saying something. The passive damage effect is invaluable to Colossal players, as the initial Volcolith will likely one-shot whatever it targets, leaving the remaining 3 Pokemon on the opponent's side of the field to have to deal with the rocks until their inevitable defeat. Something as simple as a Fake Out or Protect can cause an opposing Pokemon to get chipped into range of a KO from a move that would otherwise not have been able to pick off the Pokemon. The reason Colossal's damage over time effect is arguably the best of all is because of the low amount of rock types relevant to the format. Scrolling through Pokélytics, you'll only see 2 or 3 rock types with high enough usage to be considered when using this move, and the most relevant of them all is Colossal itself, which can be dealt with by clicking Max Volcolith. It's like they say, trust no one, not even yourself. This low amount of relevant rock types compared to water, fire, and grass types means that there are almost no Pokemon immune to the residual damage from rocks. This high damage output has led Colossal to be the face of Hyper Offense in Sword and Shield VGC. This one move may be powerful, but Colossal's high damage output is supplemented by a healthy amount of coverage moves. Likely predicting that Colossal would be shut down hard by any bulky water type, Game Freak gave Cole access to a variety of moves that would give it a fighting chance. To beat those pesky water types, Colossal has access to just one grass type move, but it's one that makes a huge difference. Solar Beam turns into a powerful Max Overgrowth that can be used to beat Tapu Fini or Urshifu Rapid Strike. While Tapu Fini is likely able to take a hit from Colossal if it Dynamaxes, this tool is still important to beating Tapu Fini if it has taken any chip damage, which with Max Volcolith active is kind of a given. On top of that, if the Colossal had used Max Flare during its Dynamax turns, the Sun would be active and thus allow for Solar Beam to be used in one turn rather than two. Colossal's access to a number of ground type moves which allow for its special defense to be raised and thus allow for it to stay on the field longer or just annihilate Pokemon like Heatran. These moves are Earth Power, Earthquake, High Horsepower, Scorching Sands, and some other low power utility moves like Bulldoze. Strangely enough, Colossal also has access to Scald of all moves. One would assume that this is just due to its lore of being a living steam engine. While this doesn't see much usage since it really only hurts Colossal's damage output coming off of Max Geyser, it's still a fun thing to note. As mentioned earlier, VGC players aim to push Colossal to its limits, so I want to talk about a brief history of Colossal optimizations. This won't be comprehensive, but I want to outline how Colossal teams have changed over time. When Sword and Shield first came out, one of the earliest Colossal teams made use of Surf Inner Focus Sneasel. This is because Sneasel had a pretty high speed stat of 115 while being immune to Fake Out flinches. Its low special attack stat of 35 made it so the damage from Surf was pretty negligible, despite being 4 times effective on Colossal. On top of that, Surf hitting everything in the field made it so the opponent would not be able to redirect the hit away from Colossal while also breaking all Focus Sashes on the field. However, around this time Conkeldurr was still a relevant threat in the metagame, so while Sneasel was immune to the flinch effect of a Fake Out plus a Mach Punch would be able to KO Sneasel before it was able to use Surf. One of the next optimizations that Colossal team saw was the addition of Dragapult as an option for an activator. Similar to Sneasel, Dragapult is immune to Fake Out flinches, not because it has Inner Focus, but because of its Ghost typing. While the Dragapult Surf will significantly hurt more because of its special attack stat of 100, having a base speed of 142 on the Coal Activator is well worth it. Dragapult also has access to dual screens, which would lower the damage output that Colossal takes from all moves. And Will-O-Wisp was also great for burning special attackers that Colossal would otherwise struggle against. Once Sword and Shield's first DLC came out, Colossal received so many new partners and tools that its viability skyrocketed. There are many places that we could start, but I think Meteor Beam is a good point to begin. In the Isle of Armor DLC, there came a number of brand new moves that a Colossal player would appreciate. Meteor Beam was a major buff to Colossal. Prior to the DLC, if the Colossal player wanted to run a special rock type move, they would have to run Ancient Power, which caps out at 60 bass power. It was essentially only ever being used to its max vocalith due to its low power. Meteor Beam, on the other hand, was a two-turn special rock move. On the first turn, the Pokemon would raise its special attack stat by one stage, then on the next turn, will hit the opponent with a base 120 special rock-type move. While this was a very powerful move while not Dynamaxed, its damage buff to max vocalith is what mattered most. Max Vocalith coming off of Ancient Power was 110 base power, while the Meteor Beam variant was 140. That is a major difference. Dragapult received access to Breaking Swipe, which would hit both opponents and always lower their attack stats. This not only allowed for Colossal to take less damage from physical attacks, but gave Dragapult the option to lower both attack stats rather than having to risk a burn to only lower one. Rillaboom received its hidden ability of Grassy Surge in this DLC. Grassy Surge activated grassy terrain, which had the passive effect of not only healing Colossal, but cutting the damage of Earthquake by one half. Colossal, being 4x weak to ground moves, appreciated this being active. Rillaboom also received access to an incredible new move in Grassy Glide, a 70 base power physical grass type move, which not only increased in power in grassy terrain, but became a priority move.
Enemy spotted. Enemy down.
These buffs to Rillaboom quickly led to it becoming the premier grass type in the format and a staple on Colossal teams, as Rillaboom was easily capable of one-shotting even the bulkiest of water types, which would otherwise threaten Colossal. The final addition to Coal teams, which came in the Isle of Armor DLC, was Urshifu Rapid Strike. This water and fighting type Pokemon had a great speed stat at 97, good physical bulk, a great attack stat of 130, and some insane new tools. Aqua Jet was essential for activating the Colossal's weakness policy with a priority move if the opponent had something that would outspeed the Dragapult on your team. But Urshifu had a new move called Surging Strikes. This was a 25 base power physical water type move which hit 3 times, each hit being a guaranteed critical hit. So it was effectively a 112 base power move that ignored any defense boost on the opponent and attack drops on the user. It's a very powerful tool to have in general, but coupled with Urshifu's ability, it was devastating to an unprepared team. Urshifu had the new ability Unseen Fist, which would cause Urshifu to bypass any Protect that a Pokemon used, with the exception of Max Guard. Past this point, the standard for Colossal teams was to have Coal, Rillaboom, Urshifu, and Dragapult, with the last two slots being filled by an alternative mode or further support. This is essentially what you can expect from a current Colossal team, as these tools may have been added in the Isle of Armor DLC, but they didn't see heavy usage together until Series 7. At that point, many new Pokemon like Landorus and Regieleki had been introduced into the format, but this optimized 4 Pokemon Colossal team had everything it needed to beat those threats. The results show with, and I'm gonna slaughter this pronunciation, Santino Tarquino and Wolf Glick winning Players Cup 1 and 2 respectively, both of which used the combination of Coal, Drag, Urshi, and Boom. Before we end off, I want to make some notes on other fun facts about Colossal that I wasn't sure where else to fit in the video. While Colossal is known for its oppressively high speed after Steam Engine activates, it can function well under Trick Room. If you were to opt to put a Dusclops as one of your Pokemon on the team, it could Trick Room and bulldoze the Colossal to lower its speed and still activate the weakness policy. Because Colossal's base speed is so low, even with max investment, it can underspeed much of the metagame before it boosts, and even more after the bulldoze speed drop. I actually used this on my Players Cup 2 qualifier team, where I used Safety Goggles Glycopod as an activator, but still carried a Trick Room option in the back. Colossal also saw some decent usage next to Zacian in Series 8, but I opted not to include it in the main body of this video because it broke the flow of standard play and Colossal's progressive optimization. But it was a great tool next to Zacian since Zacian couldn't Dynamax and the rocks provided were still very useful. Its high speed after Steam Engine allowed it to one-shot opposing Zacian with Max Flare after outspeeding them. Finally, I want to add that when the Crown Tundra DLC first came out, we saw some players make use of Choice Scarf Blacephalon as an activator. Scarf Blacephalon would use Mind Blown to activate Steam Engine while dealing devastating damage to everything on the field except Colossal, which times 4 resisted fire moves. While this did not activate weakness policy, it still allowed for the Colossal player to use Vocalith on a weakened team, likely picking up 2 KOs on turn 1. Unfortunately, the strategy left as soon as it showed up as it didn't pick up much in popularity, despite how much of a flex it really was. Needless to say, Colossal has made a major impact on the VGC metagame since its release. With that, I'd like to end off this video by asking you all what you think about Colossal. Do you think it's deserving of its status as an icon of Sword and Shield VGC and Dynamax formats as a whole, or is it overrated? Where do you stand on the whole Colossal versus Xerneas thing? Let me know what you think. Which one is more brain dead? I don't know. Let me know in the comment section down below. Like I said, I want to make these videos once a week, so if you want to fund them, please check out my Patreon page so I can create these video essays regularly. Links to my Discord and social media are below, so check them out if you'd like, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.